Hello, and welcome to KDAB News, the monthly update for professionals working with Qt, C++, and 3D technologies. I'm Robert Brock, and before we start, a last reminder for the KDAB Training Day in Berlin on the 27th of November. If you're going to QWorld Summit, just come a day earlier, and don't miss out on the super courses that are offered for Qt, QML, C++ 23, Rust, and more. Check out the agenda and sign up until the cutoff date, 15th of November. In this edition, we have Why Rust? An interview with Till Adam from KDAB and Florian Gilcher from Ferrous Systems. Heaptrack 1.5 released, tip of the month, and announcements. For some time now, we've had occasional Rust topics in the news, as Rust is coming up more and more in the public discourse. You might ask, why Rust, if the news edition is mainly for C++ and Qt developers? We will ask this question directly to Till Adam from KDAB, the leading experts for Qt and C++, and Florian Gilcher, CEO of Ferrous Systems, the leading Rust experts. Hi, Till. Hi, Florian.
Hi, Robert.
Hey, Robert.
So, Till, as mentioned, KDAB has deep expertise in C++ for over two decades. Rust seems to become more and more popular lately. What's your angle on it right now?
I would say it comes from two directions. One is that our customers are asking us about it. There has been a lot of policy activity going on in the sense that various entities and agencies internationally are asking for memory-safe languages to be used under increasingly many circumstances. And Rust obviously is one of those. So it comes up as something that customers inquire with us about. It's also been something that many of our engineers are excited about, have been looking into, and therefore getting the rest of the organization, myself included, excited about it. As you say, traditionally we are a C++ shop. And while you can, of course, use C++ safely if you know what you're doing, and I strongly believe we know what we're doing, it's still nice to have in Rust something that is kind of safe by default. So yeah, we've been looking at it from all of those three angles.
Doesn't the safety aspect apply to other languages too, though?
So the thing that is special about Rust is that it is memory safe by design, but it also doesn't have garbage collection, which means it allows native performance without kind of hard to predict behavior from a garbage collection system. And thirdly, maybe more importantly, or most importantly for us, coming from a C and C++ background, we realize that the world is full of C and C++ code, which people will not just kind of abandon and drop and rewrite entirely. So one of the things that sets Rust apart is its ability to very easily and deeply integrate with C and C++ code in both directions. So embedding Rust in existing C code and the other way around, that is a necessity, and because an incremental or partial migration is basically the reality for nearly everybody out there. And since we do software work in the real world, that is very important to us.
Another good reason for picking Rust is that it's one of the rare languages that is independently run through a foundation and not owned by a company. So it has done so for years. So it's perceived as a neutral ground where everyone can collaborate on, which gives it long-term resilience and a good outlook already for being used in all places.
And Florian, what is your perspective on the current adoption of Rust?
So my perspective on it is that Rust is being massively adopted and moving very fast into all industries. When we started, we released the language in 2015, and although we were sure we've got something there, no one thought about, okay, we're talking about actually putting it in highly critical systems, not even a decade later. And it shows in the numbers, currently Rust is in a big growth phase around the Rust community doubles around every year. And we're now talking about millions of developers actually doing it, often for their job. And the other thing is, it is not always public. Many companies don't really talk about their usage of Rust, and also may not even know about it, because what we're seeing from our side is that it's more something that comes from the engineering up into management. And suddenly people figure out, oh, someone wrote a small tool in this, someone wrote a tool there. So it is an interesting phase of adoption right now, and it's definitely picking up. And that's also the reason why we started collaborating with other companies, like, for example, KDAB, particularly because A, it becomes very hard to both have Rust expertise and have expertise, for example, in graphic systems, user interfaces, and all of these kind of things. Just plain doesn't work. And so we're now even in the phase where focused services for certain aspects of the ecosystem already become viable. And yeah, that's the phase that we're currently in. And I think the big adoption push is still coming. It's not quite there yet.
When you say it's not communicated a lot, why do you think that is?
That's a good point. When I'm saying it isn't communicated, it's more like it's not everything's in the news that people are doing. The engineers among themselves are talking quite a bit. Sometimes just nothing that, for example, reaches the company's PR blog.
Anything else you had in mind about the initial question?
Definitely. There's also an interesting regulatory push towards finally fixing the memory safety problem, particularly because of cybersecurity, growing cybersecurity concerns. And I mean, in a lot of places, memory safety, the safe languages are the default. And there's reasons why C and C++ held out, because there was just no better offer. But we're seeing with Rust, Swift, and other languages, we're seeing that gap closing quickly. Rust is the lowest level language of this, around this, which makes it the best partner to, for example, fix small parts in C and C++ code bases or rewrite them wholesale. All of those strategies are available, and it's a very flexible language at that. Also, on our collaboration, we also want to stay focused on Rust. So working with companies that have strong pedigree in C and C++ is just a natural pick for us.
That's a good explanation of why you were working with KDAB. Thank you for that. So, Till, vice versa, why has KDAB chosen to work with Ferrous Systems?
Because we like to work with the best. Obviously, we don't have the same level of depth and expertise for Rust that we have with C and C++, having done it for 20 years. And because we want to give the best possible support to our customers, we want to work with the best people to do that for the deep Rust questions that might come up. So it's very natural for us to work with Ferrous, because they're pretty much the original Rust services company. So
great. That makes a lot of sense. So before we come to the end of the interview, Florian, do you have a recommendation on how C++ developers who are interested in Rust can get started?
My usual recommendation, if you're curious about something, there's so much material around where you can start learning. The Rust project themselves writes a really, really good book called The Rust Programming Language, just to dive in. Also, we're giving small taste of courses. The one I'd like to highlight is the one we're giving at the KDAB Training Day on the 27th of November. Small intro, let's try it for a day. Let's integrate with Qt so that you get the whole feeling of how does even a Rust mixed with C++ code base look like. And I highly recommend starting early so that, well, you have some time to let things grow and your brain get a feeling for it.
Great. That sounds like a good way to start. Thank you, Florian and Till, for your time and your insights.
Yep.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
As Florian mentioned, there will be a one-day course about Rust and Qt on the 27th of November in Berlin, one day before the QtWorld Summit. Also, the market-leading multi-day Rust courses provided by Ferrous Systems are available through KDAB on our training booking website. For beginners with a general interest in Rust, there is Introduction to Rust. And for developers with a specific focus on embedded systems, there is an embedded Rust training. And for companies who have not decided to invest in Rust education just yet, There is a half-day format that will teach you what Rust is about, where it's from, and where it's going, and of course, whether it is right for you to look at Rust for your next project. This taster session includes two interactive lectures, an extended live programming demonstration, and a Q&A session. As always, we will link all interesting information in the video description below. So, if you've been hooked with Rust, look it up. As you might know, Heaptrack is a powerful heap memory profiler targeting mainly Linux as well as FreeBSD. It traces all memory allocations and annotates these events with stack traces. Dedicated analysis tools then allow you to interpret the heap memory profile. Version 1.5.0 incorporates about 70 changes since the 1.4.0 release from June last year. Like, it now supports Qt 6. You can read all about the update on the release blog linked below, or on GitHub. Do you know what a QPointer is? Or do you think you know what it is used for? Maybe it's the Qt way to store pointers, or a better kind of pointer, or maybe yet another not-invented-here Qt class solving a non-problem, or something along those lines. Our colleague Giuseppe Tangelo thinks QPointer has a terrible name and wrote a blog about it with the same title. So, what is QPointer, you might ask? QPointer is a weak pointer for Q objects. What's a weak pointer, you ask? A weak pointer is a smart pointer that does not participate in the ownership of a given object. Destroying the weak pointer has no effect whatsoever on the pointer to object. Instead, a weak pointer acts as an observer and is able to tell us whether the object has been already destroyed by its owner or owners or not. You can read more about it in the mentioned blog post, as always, linked below. Final call for the KDAB Training Day on the 27th of November in Berlin. On the day before Qt World Summit, you can take a one-day training on one of the following topics: QML architecture, porting to Qt 6, profiling Linux applications, what's new in C++ 23, and, for those interested in Rust, a taste of Rust with a drop of Qt. The sale is only open until the 15th of November, so don't miss out and get your ticket soon. Also, if you attend Qt World Summit, don't miss the keynote on The Future of Interventional Cardiac Imaging Built with Qt by LumaVision co-founder and CTO Christoph Hennersberger, together with KDAB's CCO, Till Adam. On the second day, our colleague Nicolas Arnaud-Cormont talks about script automation recording user actions. You can also meet KDAB in the exhibition area. Our experts will be there for your questions and will show you our latest demos. We'll see you there. The new training schedule for 2024 is out. If you are planning to take a training class with KDAB, you can now find all scheduled topics on our training website. You'll find intro and advanced level courses for Qt QML, modern C++, profiling and debugging, and many more. Also, we now offer Rust courses in collaboration with the leading Rust experts, Ferrous Systems. The schedule is regularly updated, so check in every now and then to see what is new, or sign up for our newsletter. The link is in the description. Are you going to SPS in Nuremberg from the 14th to the 16th of November? Then come meet KDAB in Hall 6 at booth 123. Our demos will show, among other things, maintaining a product line and interactive touch UI on cost-effective hardware platforms, and how you can adapt the same application in different frameworks on the same platform. Come and check it out. Qt Academy, the learning platform launched by the Qt Group a few months ago, has added some of KDAB's video tutorials. Among many useful courses for beginners, you can now also find selected video series extended by explanations. You can track your progress and test your learning results. The first topics added are about Qt Designer, Qt Abstract Item Views, Model View, Document Templates in Qt Creator, and Qt Designer plugins. Check it out on academy.qt.io, and if you try it out, or if you already attended other courses on this learning platform, let us know how you liked it. Thank you for watching, stay safe, and feel free to share any feedback or questions below the video. I'll see you next time.